Good evening. The opinions and statements voiced by our guests do not necessarily reflect the opinions of this network. Enjoy the shows.
You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk only on Paranormal Experience Radio. Broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Welcome to the Paranormal Experienced Radio Show with your host, Cap Hobson. We're here to learn all we can about every type of experience within the paranormal. There will be interviews with seasoned investigators of the spiritual realm, including ufologists, cryptozoologists, psychics, mediums, authors, and creators of technology, and others with credible knowledge to share. Together, we will find out what brought these investigators of the unknown into the field and learn what keeps them working so hard in it. I'm interested in learning how these individuals go about their work, and I believe you are too. This program is all about bringing those who are in the field together with our listeners who are interested in what they find. For us, the paranormal is all about working with and supporting each other. We're all here seeking answers to the questions that bother us so. Now, let's get those answers. And enjoy the show.
Good evening. Welcome to Paranormal Experienced Radio. I am so glad you are here. You are listening to Paranormal Experienced with Kat Hobson. And I am really pumped about this show. I have, a bit of upfront, information is that Randy Liebeck writes for Fate Magazine, and I am the host of Fate Magazine Radio. He is a fantastic paranormal researcher. He is a writer and a lecturer. He has worked in the television and film industry as a technical advisor and consulting advisor for TV, film, print, and media outlets. He is a consultant on ghosts and hauntings for popular television programs. He's been a columnist for Unknown Magazine and Ghost Magazine. And he is a feature writer and stringer for Fate. He has contributed to several books on the subjects of ghosts and hauntings. He has been a behind-the-scenes consultant and on-air ghost expert, which I love that he put in parentheses, for several TV programs, and actually around the world. Unsolved Mysteries, Dead Famous Ghostly Encounters, Unsolved Mysteries. He has been a guest on tons of radio talk shows, and he's been featured in several U.S. and international magazines and papers. He is somebody who has done the educational background in order to be able to do all of these things. He studied at the Rhine Institute. He studied at Edinburgh's Koestler, Parapsychology Unit, the Parapsychology Foundation, the Alvarado Zingrone Intitute for Research and Education, and the HCH Institute. And he's also an active member of the Society for Psychical Research, where he has been a parapsychological field investigator for the Office of Paranormal Investigations under the direction of Loyd Auerbach, who is someone I greatly admire, just like Randy. And Randy, I am really pleased that you are here tonight. Thank you for joining me.
Well, it's my pleasure, Kat. I'm very glad to be here with you.
Well, you have quite a background, and I find it interesting because so few people that run around saying that they're paranormal experts and researchers and such, you know, a lot of those programs that you went through are not available today. And I know that you still have supporting affiliations with the Rhine Research Center and the Parapsychological Association. So you're even, you know, a former legacy member of the International Fortean's organization, which is currently inactive. So you still have your hands in the intellectual fires as far as this stuff goes. What on earth led you into being so actively involved in the educational side of things? What was your motivation?
Well, the motivation, you know, comes with a lifelong, since childhood, interest in the world of the strange and the unknown. And I've always been research and education and reading inclined. So rather than just watching TV shows about the subject or, you know, reading pop culture magazines, I figured, well, let me actually try to get some real education on the different aspects, the history of the field. Psychical research, aka parapsychology, has been around as an organized field since around 1882.
It's
a multidisciplinary field. Parapsychology really is not its own separate standalone discipline. It's an amalgam of aspects of social sciences, psychology, sociology, anthropology, physics, neurology, medical science, and to have a grounding, at least in the basic concepts of parapsychology-based paranormal subjects, you do have to have at least an introductory grounding in those different scientific disciplines. And while I'm certainly not a scientist and I'm absolutely not an expert in any of those fields, my background is, you know, being a cop, but I have found it important that you, if you're going to discuss this, especially if you're going to put yourself out there as a quote unquote expert, which I'm not, but I and I kind of wince when some people say that, unless they're an expert in one particular area of this multiple discipline arena. But I'm certainly not an expert in any one area. I am a generalist, but I do have to have enough knowledge of the history, the science, the theoretical models, the alternative explanations for a lot of this stuff, so I can legitimately discuss the subject or teach a class on it, or you know, write an article or a book contribution on it. So it's, I think it's from necessity. I had to get education, you know, both, you know, reading on my own, subscribing to the professional journals of parapsychology, and attending every academic course, either whether in person or online, and these days everything's online.
Yes.
But to take as many programs as possible, so that, you know, I have a grounding in the overall field, and, you know, stuff changes, models and hypotheses change. Things that we thought might have been a partial explanation for this kind of stuff back in the 60s and 70s has changed. A lot of the old models have been thrown out. There are new ideas, and you have to keep up with that.
You do.
So it's a constant struggle, because I have a full-time job also, which is not part of this field. So it's, and, you know, home life and the family. I do a lot of juggling to try to stay knowledgeable and relevant in this field. But I enjoy it. Yeah, it's fun. It's fascinating. And I take it seriously. It's not just a, you know, pop culture interest for me. It's a lifelong passion. And if I'm going to talk to somebody about it, I want to at least have some sort of basis, you know, of knowledge, so I'm not, you know, just, you know, rambling incoherently. Well, sometimes I do that anyway. But.
Well, sometimes that's just part of the fun, right? And it just kind of happens.
Absolutely.
So I haven't seen anything where you've been incoherent. in your presentation. So that's pretty great. So how long have you been writing your articles? You've done Weird New Jersey, you've done Ghost Magazine, you've done How Stuff Works, you've done several things for Fate, you've got videos everywhere. It's all just so interesting. But how long have you been actually writing for Fate and these others? And how often do you present?
Not as often as I used to. Again, since COVID and with the demands of my day job, the ferocity of my activity in the field has stepped back a little bit, but the passion is still there. I still do get involved in stuff. As soon as COVID allows, I'm going to get back on the lecture circuit and go back to teaching as an adjunct instructor at a couple of local schools. That I really enjoy doing that. But really, past 2 years, I'm not out of the house much except for the day job. But I first started writing, and I write for, I've been a freelance journalist for decades on other subjects outside of the paranormal. So I did my first professional paid writing back around 1982 on law enforcement subjects. First started, I think my first paranormal pieces I've done, probably I did work for a couple of tabloids, like the Examiner, The Sun, The Midnight Globe, which I'm not proud of, but the work I did was on the up and up and they paid me for it. And I think I started first writing features for Fate around 1991 or so, which is around the same time I also first started doing lectures and teaching continuing education courses.
Well, let me ask, the courses that you teach, do you have an online component with them?
No, they were
Classroom-based?
Classroom-based, and those were at St. John's University in New York, a couple of local community colleges, and several township and county adult schools and adult education, continuing education components. And I did that a bit. And also, aside from the continuing courses, which would run for a semester or so, I've done a lot of one-off lectures at schools and colleges and historical societies and libraries and stuff over the years.
Well, we have a question from chat, and that is, what is your favorite topic to write about?
My favorite topic to write about is on whatever a magazine will pay me to write about.
I love an honest man.
My area of, again, quotation marks here, expertise, or at least my primary area of passion, is in spontaneous case phenomena, which is, in a nutshell, ghosts, hauntings, and poltergeist cases. But I have a grounding in the whole range of parapsychological phenomena. I can write and lecture about ESP, psychokinesis, clairvoyance, even touch on areas in the UFO field. While I'm not big into the UFO subject, there is some crossover between that into parapsychological and paranormal phenomena. So these are all areas I have a basic background and grounding in. One of the reasons I do take education and training very seriously, because I can't learn about all this stuff just from watching ghost adventures on TV.
Well, I'm glad that's not your basic source.
Well, it's a basic source of something, but not actual knowledge.
Well, it's my husband found an episode airing today that I had not seen. And it was interesting to watch because I don't generally. It was interesting. But they were in an area that I had thought about vacationing in. So probably I'm going to, just so I can go and investigate where they were.
It's funny. There are so many television shows right now dealing with ghost hunting and demon hunting and everything in between. And you know, I'm fascinated with these subjects, at least the ghost hunting aspect of it. I don't watch any of these TV shows. When Ghost Hunters first came on the air, it was the first of its genre, and I watched it for a season or two. And then I realized very quickly, this is not what really happens, or at least not what I've been exposed to and what I've studied. And I just lost interest. And Ghost Hunters is the tamest and mildest of the genre. You have other shows that go completely off the wall and are battling demonic forces in every house they go to.
Yes.
And I and the people I work with, for the most part, have never encountered anything that I would classify as evil or demonic. Though there are cases that I think are legitimately, at least legitimately act like that.
Yes.
People do experience
stuff.
They present
that way.
They present that way. And the reasons behind that could be multifaceted. And there are various potential explanations, including possibly demonic activity. However, those cases, I think, legitimately might be encountered one out of every 1,000 cases. At least the literature and the case reports of credentialed researchers would indicate that. And I'm just amazed how on these TV shows they encounter the demon of the week.
I know. And you just sit there and go, oh, honey, that cannot possibly be happening that often. Although I have had an experience with something that someone chose to present me with. And I actually took care of it with the help of my research partner, but it was not something I ever intended to see. I never thought I would see. And actually, I didn't physically see it. He did. So, you know, it's just kind of a unexpected moment is what it was. I was stunned. So,
folks do have those experiences.
Well,
I don't believe that. Well, I don't think it's unquestionable. People historically, including people I know and have worked with, have had those types of experiences. But you know, they are rather rare, and it is you could debate for hours what is actually behind those experiences.
You know, there's so much debate on that. You know, I'm fairly certain, because I considered that I was manifesting this, because there was stuff happening in a very unnatural manner in my home. And so I was taken by surprise. I'd never seen anything like that in my home ever. And, you know, the activity-wise, I still never saw the actual entity that my research partner said that he did. So, you know, I was having to fight my disbelief that it could happen and the obvious evidence that it was happening. It's a whole different, it was a conundrum. But we're going to go to our first break. And we'll be right back. Y'all come back too. Thanks for listening, and we'll catch you on the flip side.
Warning, the following message does not necessarily reflect the views of WBHM-DB or its hosts, guests, listeners, or of any functioning adult in general. In fact, Frank should probably seek professional help. Listener discretion is advised.
Hi there. Frank Lee here. I thought that I would spend a few moments telling you about the positivity from the network here. The overall message of para-unity and happiness, and how everyone here wants to get along with everyone out there, and how everything is just wonderful. Wait, cat's not looking. Okay, I've got something to really tell you.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you what's really going on. Honestly, all that being nice and positive crap was kind of hurting my soul, as dark as it is. So, what's really happening? Well, you see it all the time. Everybody and their brother out there has a paranormal team because they watched a couple of episodes of Ghost Hunters or some crap like that. So they go and they spend half their mortgage payment on tools and things that light up that they don't understand. And then the next logical step after buying matching black t-shirts and posing like 90s rappers for their Facebook page is to, of course, have their own podcast. Well, you know what? You're not going to find that crap here. What we have here at WBHM Digital Broadcasting is the best host, the best guest, bringing you real information. All of the hosts here on this network know their stuff. They are the people who have been out there doing the work, doing actual research. And no, by research, I don't mean binge-watching some kind of cheesy TV show on Netflix. I mean reading books. I mean out in the field doing the legwork. And who are they interviewing on their shows? They're bringing you the people they have learned from. They're bringing you the best in the field, covering all kinds of topics from UFOs and aliens to Bigfoot to cryptozoology to ghosts to anything you can think of a bit strange and unexplained. It is here, and you're going to get the best information here. So stay tuned to WBHM Digital Broadcasting. Don't go anywhere. Speaking of going somewhere, I've got to go before my mic gets cut. We'll see you there on WBHM-DB.
Welcome back to Paranormal Experience with Kat Hobson. I'm so glad you're here because Randy, my guest, is just brilliant. He has all kinds of background, and he hasn't run screaming from the Zoom call yet, so we're doing great. So, Randy, I have wanted to talk about some of your experiences because you have been everywhere. You're part of all kinds of things. And I know that you read an article called The Most Haunted House in England. Could you share that?
Certainly. That was I was contacted by a TV network in London that wanted to do a documentary about this ancient haunted manor in Gloucestershire. It was the oldest continuously occupied house in England, and had been written up in a couple of books as being the most haunted house in England. I can verify that it might be the oldest house in England. I really doubt it's the most haunted because every castle, every old house in England and anywhere around the world always claims to be the most haunted.
True.
But this location, which had been around since the Saxon times, it was built on top of a Roman temple, which was built on top of a Celtic temple to the Celtic river goddess Sabrina. And over the centuries, it had been built upon, torn down. The Saxon part of the house was then expanded throughout the British Civil War and became the house that still exists today. Starting in the 1800s, the occupants were reporting ghostly, haunting, and poltergeist activity. And the home had been in the ownership of the Macer Wright family since, I don't know exactly when, but I know one of the kids, Donald, had lived there since the 1950s. And the family and their guests had been reporting experiences, both from a classic haunting type, where you hear footsteps and apparitions were seen of various ghosts, including reenactments of battles from different wars and stuff. A lot of people were killed and murdered in that house over the centuries. And the family just knew it was haunted. And the whole town did, the whole community did. It had been written about in several books, and it was in the records of the town hall in the church. But it was just, the haunted house on the hill. But over the decades, the family reported to me when I talked to them that sometimes the activity got frightening. It would cross over into the poltergeist realm of activity, where usually, ghosts or hauntings don't physically do things, don't, touch you, don't push you or shove you. But there are numerous people in the family and the servants and workers in the house who had been physically attacked almost to a life-threatening degree. People had been physically pulled out of their beds and thrown to the floor. The activity would wane. It would get very active in certain periods of history, then die down for a while, which is not uncommon. And the Donald Macer Wright in the late 90s, I think it was, had after he became the head of the household, he had brought in various people. He had brought in ghost hunters. He had brought in psychics. He brought in clergy. Just trying to find out what the cause of this stuff was and, hopefully stop it from being frightening and assaultive. It was causing issues with his kids in the house now and with the wife. And he had not really gotten any headway of trying to get to the bottom of what was going on. So he reached out to the local media. The TV show got involved, and they wanted to bring in a team of specialists from different areas. With me as the lead investigator, I was going to look at it from the parapsychological standpoint. And they also brought in a priest. They brought in a expert in or a specialist in ley lines and earth energies, because it was the story was the manor was built on the intersection of multiple major ley lines, which might contribute to some interesting energy dynamics, which might have a play in the hauntings. Which intrigued me because of the ritual location of that plot of land. Again, originally a Celtic shrine to a goddess. Mm-hmm. When the Romans took over, they wanted to wipe out the Celtic religion, so they built their own temple on top of it. And then the house was built on top of that, which was haunted. So that plot of earth, that specific acreage, had been regarded as mystical and supernatural going back almost to the dawn of recorded history.
Absolutely.
Which was just absolutely fascinating. So the earth energies aspect was valid. They brought in a parapsychological skeptic, Nick Rose from the University of the West of England. Nick was Dr. Susan Blackmore's research assistant. And Nick and Dr. Blackmore were very skeptical of this. They research parapsychology, but they believe it's all in the mind. It's all aspect of human psychology rather than anything external, rather than it being a ghost or anything. So I was out there for a week, and all of us worked together, applying our own approaches to what might be going on. I used the instrumentation to see if I could detect any of these possibly weird environmental energy signatures, and I did. I interviewed current homeowners and the family and staff and folks who had worked there in the past, talked with historians in the town just to get the a total historical background of the phenomenology and the history. And the psychologist / parapsychologist, you know, just developed psychological profiles of everybody to try to explain away why they were imagining all of this stuff.
Can I interrupt you for a moment?
Mm-hmm.
I have a question. When you were testing for the unusual energy, the anomalous energy, I'm assuming looking for what the ley lines were helping to create, what minerals and such could have been there also, everything. Mm-hmm. I know that you were looking at all of that. How did you test for that?
Well, we don't know what these energies, and that's another word I'm putting in quotation marks, because it's a supposition. We think something's going on at this and other locations. If what's going on impacts people, if people can feel it, sense it, hear things, see things, there's something going on objectively or subjectively in the environment that people can perceive. That implies some sort, since it's nothing solid, since you're not being hit by a brick, but people are still feeling things, the assumption is there's some sort of energy that people are perceiving. So what that is, we don't know. If ley lines do have energy dynamics, like several researchers put forward, and I don't know if I completely buy that or not, but I can't dismiss it as a possibility.
Right.
But we don't know what we're looking for. So we try, and what I do is I use the shotgun approach. We do know that at some locations, there are unusual signatures in the electromagnetic environment. And in haunted locations, very often fluctuating magnetic signatures. They don't necessarily have to be very high, very strong. They can be rather low level, but it's the fluctuation of them rapidly, which seems to impact the human percipient. And in some cases, very strong electromagnetic or electrostatic fields that can be generated by artificial, energy sources like power lines, or having the building directly underneath a high tension, power pylon. There is a school of thought with some documentation indicating that exposure to that might cause hallucinations or cause sensations of presence, sensation of fear. So we look for that, which you detect just by using a regular AC electric meter to see if you're picking up high things in the air. With different mineral and crystal content in the ground, which some people say can play a part in what makes a place haunted as opposed to not haunted. We don't know what kind of energy signature, quartz in the ground can give off, short of a piezoelectric emission from geological stress. And so we're just using AC, DC detection equipment for electricity, using ionizing radiation meters. In English, that's a Geiger counter.
Thank you for that translation.
We're looking for, I used microwave detection equipment because it's always possible. We identified that there was very far away, but within line of sight up a mountain, there was a Ministry of Defense installation, British military, and it's quite possible they might have had some sort of transmission equipment, radar dishes, who knows what, that we might have been in the path of, and maybe
that's true. That's definitely something to consider.
So we want to see if we can isolate and maybe rule out artificial sources, natural sources. We picked up no microwave anything. We picked up no ionizing radiation. We did pick up apparently an alternating current electrical field, which passed through the house in a tight beam. It came from outside. It passed through the house through one wall about five and a half feet off the ground, went through several walls, through several rooms, and exited the house.
That is anomalous, so, is it not? Yeah.
Well, it's anomalous, which just means it's something different, unusual. We're not expecting it, and we couldn't quite figure out what's causing it. And when I say it came outside the house and into the house and outside the house, that is incorrect. Going outside the house, there was no field. There was no point of entry into one wall. And then inside the house where it ended, it did not come outside the house on the other side of that wall. So we figured, okay, it's something being generated inside the house. It's AC, which implies electrical,
Yes.
Yeah. You can pick up those same fields if you walk by your refrigerator with a magnetometer. So we shut off the main power to the house. We shut everything down. The field was still there. It was still persisting. There was nothing that could be generating it. Don't have a clue what it was. And we could actually trace out the diameter. Diameter was about 4 to 5 inches circular, like a pipe.
Yes.
Traversing through the house, and if you move the meters and equipment, 2 inches away from it, the meters went dead. So it was a very tightly defined beam of energy. And now, did that have anything to do with the haunting or people's experiences? No way to ascertain that. But the rooms that it passed through were the rooms where people, going back hundreds of years, have reported experiencing and seeing things.
Well, my
when we shut the power off, nothing, it was still there, but there was nothing going on. The house was totally dead power wise. So even our skeptical parapsychological assistant couldn't figure that one out. And he was helping me trace the outline of the field.
Was there a possible source under the house? Because I know that they didn't build it flat on the Roman ruins. There had to be some space.
That's quite possible, but I can't figure out what could be under the house.
Creating
what we define as artificial electricity. Mm-hmm. AC fields are not, to the best of my knowledge, not found in nature. They are technology generated.
Okay.
And there was no technology under the house, and the fact that the field did not generate or come off of any structural surface in the house. It was floating about five and a half feet above the floor. And if it was being generated from something under the house, the field would have reached down to the floor. So that was an anomaly. I can confidently say that. I suspect that it might have had some connection with the reports of hauntings in the house, but couldn't prove it. Now, while I was there, nothing else anomalous occurred. Our psychic said she sensed disturbed spirits in the house. I'm not psychic, so I can't verify that or counter that one way or the other. The priest, who is a very well-regarded paranormal expert with the Church of England, who has worked many, in addition to exorcisms of demonic-type activity, he had worked hundreds and hundreds of what we call run-of-the-mill compared to, demonic stuff, but run-of-the-mill hauntings and poltergeists. He's very experienced, and he said he felt very strongly the presence of something in the house, something that was disturbed, was angry, and that it definitely did occasionally attack and try to harm some of the occupants. Again, that was his, clerical perspective, but he is also very highly educated and trained in the parapsychology end of things, because the church used him to counsel, parishioners who were, experiencing these things and needed to hear expert advice on what it might be. So he wasn't just, clerical. He was also a paranormal specialist in this. And so he said he felt stuff. I have no reason, to doubt what he was saying. But I didn't, you know, experience or encounter anything other than that energy field, which is the norm for me. I am not really sensitive to this kind of stuff. I have to use instrumentation or rely on people who are sensitive. At the end of our stay there, the last day, and the whole time we were there, it was overcast. It was dreary. The typical, you know, English, you know, misty, you know, cold, foggy atmosphere. The birds weren't chirping. The sun was not coming out. The last day we were there, right before we left, this is all being filmed, you know, for this TV documentary. The owner of the house asked the priest, Reverend Tom Willis, hey, can you do some sort of ceremony or exorcism of the house and try to clear this up? So Tom says, sure, I can try that. It's not really an exorcism. It's a clearing a process. So he wandered through the house doing that. And it was, from my standpoint, it was an exorcism. He was using religious verbiage and sprinkling holy water on all the walls and making the sign of the cross on all the walls and the holy water, and, you know, telling, you know, anything evil, you know, the snares of the devil to leave and not come back. So I would call that a minor exorcism.
Sounds like an exorcism to me.
Yep. So he did that room to room. I was outside talking with the film crew and doing some final readings of my stuff. When Tom got to the last room and got to the front door of the house, he sprinkled the holy water, said his thing, and then said amen. The moment he said amen, the clouds parted, the sun burst through, and the birds started chirping.
Get out.
I'm sitting there with the other researchers and the film crew. We all just turned and looked at each other.
Yep.
And then looked back at Reverend Willis. And it was just, it was amazing. This, it couldn't have been more perfect if it was the Steven Spielberg movie. Amen. And the clouds part, the sun and the birds and the entire atmosphere became noticeably lighter. There was a gloom and density over the house and the grounds for the whole week. And then it just lifted in a moment. And, I'm not a holy roller when it comes to religious issues, but I don't discount the possibility that what Reverend Willis and other clergy do in some cases, you know, can have a positive effect, whether they're actually making the snares of the devil leave the house or whether it's just, you know, through positive intent that they, like possibly many other people, if not everybody, can cause changes in the environment through focused intent. A type of psychokinesis in action, but yes. whatever the mechanism might have been, Reverend Willis apparently had it, and it was just like one of the most perfect cinematography moments ever in history. And it might have just been coincidental. It could have been.
No,
that's when the clouds were
going apart. It's more fun to say nay.
Yeah, and it was a physical change in atmosphere.
Yes.
We all felt it
literally.
Yeah. So
we have to go to our second break. I'm so sorry, because this is fascinating. But we'll be right back. And y'all come back too.
You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... nope. That'll do. Hello. I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown. all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experienced Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Welcome back to Paranormal Experience with Kat Hobson. Thank you so much for being here, and I have to tell you, this is already a fascinating show. Randy, your experiences are fantastic, and we're just now getting into them. But we have a couple of questions for you that I'd like to pull from chat. And one is, from what Sherry is hearing, your cases have involved many people coming in to help investigate. What was your longest case, and what was it about?
Well, some cases I work with a team of experts from various disciplines. People with a background in psychology, folks with different backgrounds. In this one case, I worked with an exorcist, and I work with psychics on occasion. Sometimes it's just me. Sometimes maybe one other investigator. It depends on the specific case, specific location, and what I think is needed. The longest case I worked lasted about 2 years. This was a haunting in Dutchess County, New York, where a neighborhood, about four or five houses, all on the same street and around the corner, had been haunted since the 1930s by the ghost of a little girl who would wander from house to house crying for its mother. And I had talked to one of the neighbors around the corner who remembers, she was in her 90s when I talked to her, and she remembered when she was a little girl that the ghost would come around, and everybody in the neighborhood knew about it. It was just like the neighborhood ghost, nothing ever, you know, frightening or scary. We had a woman who moved in to one of the houses that I could not verify, but I think was one of the originally haunted ones before she moved in. She moved in with the family, two small children, and her husband, but very early on started going through a divorce, and there was a lot of stress and emotional turmoil in the house. And the activity in her house then moved into the poltergeist arena. It went from just being the ghost of a little girl wandering around crying for her mother to physical and sometimes assault of poltergeist activity. The dishes and glassware would explode in her kitchen when no one was near it. She would be shoved. Her youngest, the baby who was in the crib, was being messed with by whatever was there. Something kept lowering the side slats on the crib, endangering the baby, who could now fall out of the crib. And the homeowner would come back in, lock the slats back up, and it would keep happening. I wonder to this day whether that was the poltergeist, you know, the nasty part of this, or whether it was this little girl's ghost who maybe just wanted to play with the baby. We just don't know. Then this woman started visiting, you know, the neighbors at the other houses. And then when she would visit the houses, shortly thereafter, these houses, which had only experienced a totally non-threatening little girl's ghost, you know, for decades, after this one woman who was going through stress and emotional issues with a divorce, when she would visit these houses, then leave, the poltergeist activity would then start up in those houses. It seemed she left some sort of contagious residue at the places she visited. So she had contacted me. I think she had reached out to Loyd Auerbach in California, briefed him on the case, and he suggested that she call me because he couldn't get out to New York State at the moment. So I worked the case initially, just me, and then I brought in other people to assist me. I had Peter Jordan, who is a paranormal researcher who's worked a lot of cases. Pete Jordan was one of the first investigators at the Amityville Horror case. He was actually in the house right after the Lutzes left, and he was one of the first people to suspect it was a hoax. So we spent some time out there. Carrie Gaynor, parapsychologist from Los Angeles, helped out on the case. Had various psychics come in, a psychological therapist. What I think was going on, I think we had a neighborhood with a little girl's ghost. And the local legend was, back in the 30s or even before that, a little girl had fallen down a well and died. And ever since then, she had haunted the neighborhood. And we think we found the well, but, you know, there's no way, there were no police records of this, which is not uncommon. It's not that easy to find police records of accidental deaths going, you know, back. We didn't even know when. We wouldn't know what year.
Exactly.
Archives to search. So we could never verify that. So that might be true, or it might just be a local folkloric legend. But the neighborhood had been haunted, you know, for decades. And now, with the arrival of this one woman who was going through certain family and emotional dynamics, which we believe can often trigger poltergeist activity, which the model we use suggests it's not, has nothing to do with a ghost. It's the person psychokinetically and subconsciously impacting the environment around them. But in this case, it was complicated because there was a ghost. I strongly suspect there was, and it had been there before the poltergeist activity started. And I suspect that the poltergeist activity mingled and interacted with the existing haunting, and the two kept energizing each other. In fact, several of the people in the neighborhood who had been hearing, usually hearing, but some people actually seen the little girl, they said that after the activity started, in the poltergeist activity, the little girl's appearances and hearing her voice calling for her mother changed, and she sounded frightened. And people said they got the impression that the girl was frightened and was frightened by something else, which had now entered the environment, had entered the neighborhood, which I suspect is whatever was behind the poltergeist. And it seemed to enter on. So this process developed and increased in intensity over a 2-year period. So I would go back and forth. And one of my most interesting personal experiences, and I said, I usually don't encounter stuff myself. I'm as sensitive as a brick when it comes to this stuff. But in this case, I experienced stuff from the get-go, and even before I actually got out there, even talking with this woman on the phone, the first phone call, stuff started happening. Well, she'd called me up and I'm asking her, tell me what's going on, and she's telling me the stories. And one of the things and she was obviously very scared, if not so much for herself, she was scared for the kids in the household. So I was trying to calm her down and making some suggestions over the phone about some things which might moderate or mitigate the phenomenon. I said, hey, here's some things you can try. In many cases, if the ghost is doing something which, you know, scares you, try talking to it. Say, hey, you know, whoever you are, this is my house now. If you're going to be here, you know, okay, be here, but don't endanger the baby. Don't, you know, mess with the baby's crib. Don't scare the baby. Don't make, you know, glasses shatter in the kitchen because that can hurt somebody. Because that witness, her name was Julie, she was concerned because she thought if it was the ghost of a lost little girl looking for her mother, she didn't want to tell the ghost, you know, you're banished, or be gone. You know, she actually had some sort of, you know, sympathetic resonance with what might have been a little girl's spirit. So she didn't want to, you know, throw holy water on the wall and say, "Be gone, evil spirit." So we tried some suggestions, you know, try this, try that. Whenever I would say, try this, here's something that's worked in other cases. Here's, here's an idea. Every time I would say that, this loud, roaring electronic static would come over the phone line and would drown me out and would drown her out. As soon as I would stop giving suggestions about what to do to mitigate the haunting phenomena, the crystal clear communications. But once I'd say, another thing that you might want to try, and as soon as I would say that, electronic feedback that would completely drown out the situation. This kept going on for several minutes and was timed exactly with what I was saying. It was only when I was giving suggestions which might control or mitigate the ghost's activity or the poltergeist's activity. Julie on the other end did not hear the static or the electronic roaring sounds. She heard a gruff, loud male voice come over and start threatening her and using profanity. You know, if I was saying, tell the ghost not to bother the kids, then I would hear static. Julie would hear this profane male voice saying, yeah, I'll tell you what I'm going to do to your kids, and would tell her in a not polite language. And Julie said she knew it was not me because it was not my voice. I didn't hear that. I heard the static. But
well, Angie wouldn't say that.
Yeah. And no, I wouldn't say that. That would kind of destroy me, and not only in my paranormal career, but if word got back to my day job, I'd be in serious trouble.
Exactly.
It was whatever it was. It was intelligently responding to what was being said. And it was affecting us on both ends of the conversation differently, but at the same time. Now, if this is poltergeist activity that, you know, in some cases is generated by the living person, maybe she was subconsciously doing this herself and affecting the electronic signal over the phone, or maybe it was some external force or entity that was doing this. I don't know. But it was certainly traveling through the phone line from her to me. And that's the first conversation. So after that, I said, well, something, I'm now interested in this case. I want to fall out there. I want to drive out there and see her. So a couple of days later, I get in my car, I'm driving to New York State. I'm on the road for maybe half an hour, 45 minutes, and my car started sputtering and stalling. I would push the accelerator down, the car would not go. And my first thought, well, my goodness, my car is breaking down. I didn't think anything. It was anomalous about it. Just the car was breaking down, even though this car had never had any problems before. So I say, okay, I can't keep driving to New York. I turn around, start heading back home. Almost as soon as I turn back around, the car is running fine. Well, I'm heading in the direction of home. So I'm driving for about 15 minutes. Everything's fine. I go, okay, you know, whatever it was transient, you know, maybe a little bit of, you know, water was in the gas tank and it's worked its way through the engine. Now I turn back around, heading back to New York. Within 3 to 4 minutes, the exact thing, same thing starts happening again. Cars sputtering, no acceleration. Of course, I don't want to get stranded on the New York thruway.
True that.
I turn around, start heading home again. As soon as I'm turning around and my intention is I'm not going to New York. I'm heading home. Car working fine again. But I kept going home. And then after that, car never had that problem again. There was nothing mechanically wrong with it. It struck me at the time, and I'm still convinced to this day, something knew I was going to this location and actively work to prevent me from getting there. Now, eventually, a couple of weeks later, I did get out there, and this did not repeat itself. But that one day, the dynamics of that were just—I don't think it stretches my credibility to think that it was just coincidental. It seemed that something was actively trying to interfere with me.
Well, you know, they do know when we're coming. And particularly, you had already been interfered with, you know, when you were helping verbally. So mm-hmm. it stands to reason that they were not going to want you coming into the home. But we're at the top of the hour. I don't know where that first hour went. That was so fast. But we will come right back and we will continue this fantastic interview with Randy Liebeck. And I am so thrilled that you're here, Randy. We will be right back after this news break. This is a good time to stretch your legs. If you're Brian D. Parsons, you might want to toss a cartwheel out. And we will see you on the flip side. Thank you so much for listening. Welcome back to WBHM Digital Broadcast.
This message comes from NPR sponsor Spectrum Business. To help small business owners cut their internet and phone costs, Spectrum Business has created a new savings calculator. Go to spectrum.com/business calculator and you can see how much you'll save by switching to Spectrum Business. Restrictions apply.
Live from NPR News in Washington, I'm Jack Speer. President Biden traveled to his hometown of Scranton, Pennsylvania today to again talk up his Build Back Better plan. Biden saying for too long the middle class has been footing more than its share of the tax bill, while billionaires and some Fortune 500 firms paid little or no federal taxes. Speaking at the Electric Trolley Museum there, Biden noting American highways in many cases are crumbling due to disrepair.
There are 173 miles of roads in poor conditions that have to be built up, including more than 3,300 bridges and over 7,500 miles of highways here in the state of Pennsylvania that need to be repaired and built.
Biden said the U.S. once ranked first in terms of infrastructure. It's now fallen to 13th. He also said his larger spending plan, which is being scaled back to roughly $2 trillion, will not increase the federal deficit. For the third time this year, Senate Republicans have blocked action on federal voting rights legislation using the Senate procedure known as the filibuster. As NPR's Juana Summers explains, Democrats say federal legislation is needed to offset a wave of new voting restrictions from GOP-led states.
Senate Republicans have blocked debate on a voting rights bill that the White House has described as a must-pass priority. Among other things, it would establish Election Day as a national holiday and set national minimum standards for early voting and vote by mail. It also includes standards for states that require voter ID. 60 votes are needed to break a filibuster. In the closely divided Senate, that means 10 Republicans would have needed to join Democrats. But Republicans, including Minority Leader Mitch McConnell, have said the effort is a political power grab by Democrats and an attempted federal government takeover of elections. Juana Summers, NPR News, the Capitol.
The White House says it's operationally ready to roll out COVID-19 vaccines for children. As NPR's Ping Wong reports, it's pending authorization from the FDA and the CDC.
Dr. Anthony Fauci, chief medical advisor to the president, says kids 5 to 11 years old should get vaccinated as soon as they are able.
In the era of Delta, children get infected as readily as adults do, and they transmit the infection as readily as the adults do.
Over the next 2 weeks, the FDA and CDC are having public discussions on whether the data on Pfizer's COVID-19 vaccine show they are safe and effective in children. There are 28 million kids ages 5 to 11 in the U.S. Fauci says that half of all kids who get infected are asymptomatic, so getting most of them vaccinated would play a major role in stopping the virus from spreading in their communities. Ping Huang, NPR News.
A mixed close on Wall Street. The Dow was up 152 points. The Nasdaq closed down 7 points today. This is NPR. The Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation says it will spend $120 million to boost access to generic versions of drug maker Merck's antiviral COVID-19 pill for lower-income countries. Once government regulators approve the drug, the private foundation says it will use the funds to support the range of activities required to develop and manufacture generic versions. Merck has licenses technology to generic drug makers in India. The company said it will provide licenses to manufacturers to supply the drug to India and more than 100 other lower and middle income countries. A new study shows parents want greater racial and ethnic diversity in the media their children watch. As NPR's Elizabeth Blair reports, the study by Common Sense Media says Hollywood entertainment continues to fall short.
Common Sense Media surveyed more than 1,100 parents and caregivers of children between the ages of 2 and 12. The demographics were representative of the U.S. population. Nearly 80% said they want their children to be exposed to media that teaches them about different cultures, religions, and lifestyles.
Hola, soy Dora, and I'm Phil.
For positive representation, caregivers gave high marks to shows like Dora the Explorer and Sesame Street. Cited among the worst were Grand Theft Auto and content on YouTube. The report found that characters of color most watched by children are more likely to be depicted as violent. Elizabeth Blair, NPR News.
Crude oil futures prices rose to a new 7-year high today following stocks higher. Oil up 1.3% after earlier in the session losing ground. I'm Jack Spear, NPR News in Washington.
How do we reinvent ourselves? And what's the secret to living longer? I'm Anoush Zomorodi. Each week on NPR's TED Radio Hour, we go on a journey with TED speakers to seek a deeper understanding of the world and to figure out new ways to think and create. Listen now.
Welcome back to WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. The time is 5 minutes after the hour.
Welcome back to Paranormal Experienced with Kat Hobson. I'm so glad you're here. We are having a great discussion, and my guest, Randy Liebeck, is just really fascinating. We have been discussing all kinds of things, different cases, a little bit of what his motivation to actually be as dedicated to this topic was, and trust me, he is. And you know, he's got a fantastic website. It's ghosthunter.iwarp.com, and the homepage is fascinating. He has the investigative protocols that he utilizes, articles, videos, links, lectures and appearances, and media services too. If anybody would like to go and check that out to book him. But Randy, I had to run for that break, and I kind of cut you off with a little bit left to go, and I apologize for that. Can you please continue?
Okay, just to close out that story, the activity continued for over 2 years after I was brought in. We had noticed that the activity, especially the poltergeist, the physical activity, where things moved and people were touched or shoved, really got out of control when two people in the neighborhood would get together. The woman who had called me in, and whenever she would visit her next door neighbor, when they were together in either house, either in Julie's house or the neighbor's house, stuff would always kick off. So those two being together created some sort of dynamic, which really fueled the fire in this case. So again, 2 years I worked the case, bringing in different investigators and different subject matter experts, working with at different houses and working with the different percipients. The activity in the case came to a close when both of those people in the two different houses moved away. One moved away just because they were planning on moving away anyway. The other woman, the one who called me in, actually moved away pretty much in the middle of one of the investigations we were doing, because she just got fed up with what was going on. And the activity followed her to the new house that she moved into. It followed her, and activity continued in her second house for a couple of weeks, no longer than a couple of months. Then it just stopped, which we actually expect to see in poltergeist cases. Very often when a person moves to a new home, the activity does transfer with that person, but then dies out very quickly. And we saw that exactly. What intrigues me about this case is that it doesn't fit in with the parameters of what we're told in the world of parapsychology delineates different phenomena. there are elements of this that were a haunting. The little girl's ghost was the initial phenomena that was either a residual haunting place memory, but because the girl seemed to be interactive, the ghost would communicate with people. And if you approached the little girl's ghost and tried to, you know, make contact, it would actively move away from you. That suggests it was not a recording. That suggests it was an actual a ghost, some sort of surviving consciousness. But ghosts don't make glassware explode. They don't make the air get cold, because stuff would get frigidly cold when people were having these experiences. Ghosts don't usually mess with babies' cribs. One of the women called me from a Barnes & Noble because she's at the Barnes & Noble looking at the paranormal books, trying to find a book that might help her try to come to terms with what's going on. And while she's looking through the books, something invisible pushed her down, knocked her into the books, and all the books fell on top of her.
Oh, no.
Ghosts of little girls don't do that. So this was an outlier case. There was a lot of crossover between different types of phenomena that we are told in the parapsychology textbooks are separate and different events. And I've found, and many other researchers are finding, that those lines are not that thick, that the line between ghost haunting and poltergeist is often very thin, with lots of gaps. And that was definitely the case here. And I still am fascinated by what was reported and what I experienced.
Well, would you have believed it had you not experienced it yourself?
Yeah, I would have, just from doing the interviews, because the stories were cohesive. The phenomena that was reported, even though it was crossover, you know, from haunting to ghost to poltergeist, the phenomenology reported fit in with what we actually do expect to see in these cases. As part of my screening process, I made some suggestions along the lines of, well, you know, okay, you said this happened and this has happened and you experienced this, but what about this? What about that? Because we often expect to see this and that and this other thing in real cases. The reasoning behind that is, if somebody thinks I'm expecting to hear specific phenomena and they want me to believe them, if they're lying, they will then say, oh, yeah, you know, yeah, you're right. I forgot about that. This happened and A, B, and C happened. But I'm just making that up. These are things that we do not expect to see in real cases. They are not commonly reported outside of horror movies, and none of the witnesses took the bait. They said, no, that never happened, but this happened, that happened. So they passed the screening process, and then when I brought other very experienced researchers and psychological specialists, there was no indication of any fraud. And that was even, you know, that would have been the case if I had sent these folks in and I had not gone myself. But once I was there, I did witness experience before I got there. And then after there, over the 2-year period, I and other researchers saw movement of objects. We saw a poltergeist case activity, kinetic movement and manipulation of objects occurring while we were there. A few different things. It was not every day, it was not every visit. Again, this is, you know, a few things over a period of a couple of years. While yes, I would have believed the stories, even without that, being there and seeing some of these things, which correlated with what they said they had seen before I was ever there, that was the icing on the cake.
Well, I tell you, that's just astounding to me, too. I've never experienced that to the extent that you did. I've experienced poltergeistic activity in a case. I have experienced being interfered with in a case, and I have experienced someone or something trying to intimidate me to back me out of a case. I get called the B word an awful lot over my voice recorders. It's just ridiculous. But, because I'm not. I'm not an antagonistic investigator. I am not provocative. And I will just catch that sometimes. And I never quite know what to think. But we've got to get to these questions because she's right. We may have to go till midnight at this rate because we've got about 5 minutes before our break. But is there any particular paranormal equipment that you're a fan of, or do you feel like they're all a bunch of hooey? That's a Southern term, by the way.
Hey, I'm from North Carolina, so I'm very well schooled in hooey. My answer to that is 50%. Yes, there's some equipment I think is useful, and 50%. No, it's all hooey. With equipment, the first thing is we don't know exactly what it is we're looking for. We don't know what energy is out there that might be detectable. We don't know what a ghost is, so we do not know. We can't even prove they exist, though. I'm convinced that something is out there. But we cannot isolate it. We cannot categorize it with any real effect. And we don't know what type of energy is being used, you know, by a ghost to interact with the environment. But just on observation, ghosts and or poltergeist manifestations do interact with the environment. They do move things. People do feel things. Sometimes there are temperature drops. So something is happening in the environment. Our operating model for this is if something is impacting the environment, it's operating within the world of physics as we understand it, right. At least sometimes. And if something is following the laws of physics and manipulating the environment, there has to be some sort of energy expenditure. So something theoretically should be detectable. We're not sure what. In some cases, we do pick up unusual electromagnetic signatures, often lightly fluctuating. In some cases, I and other researchers, Bill Roll and a few others, have gotten ionizing radiation on a Geiger counter. At locations, which seems to correlate with other experiences. The radiation is detectable while other things are going on, while there are sounds, visual apparitions. And then though that's over with, the radiation signature stops. In some cases, electrostatic energy in the air. People report, you know, the hair on their arm standing up, or a sensation of a cool breeze, or they feel like they've been touched. All of that can be caused by electrostatic electricity in the environment. So we look for that. And sometimes we detect that also. But it's hit or miss. Yes. And I can't understand why, if in one case we can pick up these apparently anomalous environmental readings, in other cases where the exact same phenomena seems to be occurring, we pick up nothing. So it does not work on demand. And so for that reason, I'm not a big fan of people going out and spending thousands of dollars on the latest ghost hunting gear, because it's totally speculative. There are no specter detectors because we don't know what a specter is. True. So we're using stuff to detect changes in the environment. Even if we can document that, we can't prove that's the ghost. We can't prove that we're picking up the ghost. We can't prove that we're picking up some energy the ghost is expending to manipulate the environment. I think that is a reasonable supposition, and that's why we use this equipment.
Right.
But we can't be sure. There are no guarantees.
Well, there are no guarantees, but when you have repetitive experiences with outcomes of experimentation, then the supposition is well-based.
Yeah, and over the decades, when we've had these types of handheld devices, again, not on demand, not 100% of the time, but we've had interesting, intriguing results with magnetic field detectors, electrostatic detectors. Mm-hmm. Some researchers get some very good effects on audio recordings, EVP. I've never gotten an EVP myself. I've worked cases
ever
where I'm never. I've worked cases where I'm standing right next to another investigator who, while I'm standing there, will record Class A EVPs on their recorder, and not just random sounds and random bits of words, but sometimes in relatively clear, intelligent commentary on what we're doing and what's going on, including our names being used. But my recorder, which is sitting 1 foot from the other recorder, has never picked up anything. So I am not a ghost magnet. But those my lack of success with EVPs indicates to me that a large part of this is dependent on who the investigator is. I think some people are ghost magnets. Some people, the stuff just happens around them. Other people are ghost or paranormal inhibitors. When nothing happens,
I would agree with that too.
I'm in the inhibitor side, which is why, you know, I'll use whatever equipment I can. I'll bring in people who claim to be psychic, claim to be mediums, and see what they feel. And then other investigators who are not. I work with my brother on cases, and we've worked cases in the past. Again, I'm standing right next to him. He's getting intriguing, apparently intelligent communications that are pertinent to the immediate situation, and I'm getting nothing. So I like working with him whenever I can, because he's my ghost.
Teamwork.
So for me, using EVP, I always run audio recorders. I run a video camera, which has sound, you know, audio recording on it also. But I'm not really expecting to capture anything at this point. But I use the equipment. I have it. So, but I'm not going to run out and buy the latest, newest, you know, more expensive device, because I think for me, at least, it's an exercise in futility.
I understand. Well, we have to take this quick little break, and we will be right back. And we have more questions. So you're fascinating. This is fantastic. Thank you. And y'all come back too. We're just going to go and do this thing.
You're listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama. Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown, all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting. You are listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio. Broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... Nope. That'll do. Hello, I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
We are confident that none of our hosts are possessed. Being repossessed a few times, that might be a different story. You are listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting, Birmingham, Alabama.
Thank you for listening to WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. The time is 23 minutes after the hour.
Welcome back to Paranormal Experience with Kat Hobson. My guest, Randy Liebeck, and I are just having some of those best between, you know, during the break conversations. And I always say someday somebody's going to start recording those, but it's not going to be me. I like being able to have those conversations. But yeah, we were discussing EVPs and the clarity that you can sometimes get. Randy, I am just so much enjoying you and your experiences. But are you ready for another question?
Oh, I'd love another question.
Well, I know that I had mentioned one, but I want to know the answer to this one. And we'll come back to the other one if it's, yeah, if we have time. But have you ever, in the paranormal, been in a situation where you're concerned about your own life or your own well-being?
Well, never concerned about my life. This activity, except in certain outlier poltergeist cases, the activity is basically not dangerous. Some people are pushed, shoved, bit, scratched.
Right.
Anything beyond that, well, I'm not going to say it's never happened. It's never been recorded in the literature of the field, except for the John Bell case in Tennessee in the 1800s. Right. That's very questionable historically. So I'm not really afraid of ghosts or poltergeists. I sometimes do cases in the inner city, Newark, New Jersey. I work at a haunted cemetery, and there are people you may encounter in a cemetery at night in Newark, New Jersey that you don't want to encounter. But yeah, but I've also been a cop since 1985 and carry a gun when I go out on cases. So, but I'm not afraid of ghosts or spirits. I have encountered stuff which was frightening. One time frightening, and that was not, I wasn't working a case. This, I was at home and I encountered something in my home, just a bolt out of the blue, which enveloped me in a sense of absolute terror that lasted for a little while until it faded away. Kind of stuff you hear about people experiencing, you know, at haunted locations. I don't experience it at a haunted location. I experienced that in the safety, what I thought was the safety of my own home. But that was, you know, if I could have bolted and ran, you know, out of the house, I would have, but the circumstances were not conducive for that at the moment.
Really?
Another time, again, when I was not looking for ghosts, I was driving. I went to visit my old junior high school in area in North Carolina. And I was with a friend of mine, and we're driving around the back of the school, just cruising through the resurrect some memories of our days there. And as we drove behind the building down the driveway, all of a sudden, bolt out of the blue, this sense of terror enveloped both of us. And it was the exact same sensation I felt decades later in my house that I was just telling you about.
Right.
But we crossed a line, a definite line that we passed. And this absolute sense of terror, we both looked at each other and simultaneously said, "Holy crap, do you feel that?" And then we bolted. We just went forward very fastly, and we left that field. And I said, "Hey, we need to see what the heck that was." So we turned around, drove through it again, and that exact same spot. And it was, I don't know how wide it was, but it had to have been at least 10 feet deep, because we would pass through it, but after 10 feet of movement through it, it was gone. So it had specific locality in space. It was here at this point, but not before or beyond it. We then drove around again. We drove around the entire school grounds. We wanted to experience this the third time. When we came back around the third time, it was gone. But it was a palpable, almost physical zone of, I don't know what it was, but it just immediately, instantly, and very definitely enveloped you in a in a field of fear and terror that just made you think, oh my God, I have to run. I have to get out of here now, or something very, very bad is going to happen. Well, what that could have been, I don't have a clue. And it was transient. It was there, then it wasn't there.
Well, that's what I was going to say, because I have run into people, living humans, who exude that energy. But I'm also very sensitive to energy. And so it's even possible that that could have been a living human who was having some sort of mental issue. But
yeah, I have
experienced spirits like that too, but I've also experienced the human side of that, and it's just as scary.
Yep. And that's the question, you know, the effect was real. I experienced
absolutely.
It and my friend there, so I have a witness,
absolutely.
Experienced it simultaneously. So it was real. The question is, what caused that?
Yes.
Was it something, you know, that was just being generated from the earth itself, some sort of anomalous, you know, energy field because of, you know, the mineral content in the ground? I don't know, but I would think that would be a constant. It wouldn't have been gone the third
time. That would be a constant.
And if it was a spirit, a human spirit of some sort, and we passed through that, well, then that person took up space that was 10 feet deep.
Yes.
Because, you know, we passed through a pretty thick field of this. It wasn't just like, you know, passing through something the size of a person. So it doesn't make sense to me. And I can't really explain what it could have been.
The logic escapes on those moments. You know, because when you start narrowing things down, you come out at the end of the paranormal. But and you were in a vehicle, right? You're two people in a vehicle, in a car.
We're not looking for anything anomalous.
Right?
We were just reminiscing about our days in junior high school. Now, interestingly, there is a local legend that on the grounds of the school, before the school was built, there was an orphanage there. And the orphanage had burned down. And there was a local legend that we all knew when we were students there that the school grounds were haunted by all the kids who died when the orphanage burned down. That was, you know, you heard that story the first day you went to school
right.
there. But the orphanage was on the other side of the building. We were in the back. The orphanage was in where the tennis court is in the front. And I have researched the case in depth since then. Yes, there was an orphanage. Yes, it did burn down. No one died in the fire. There was no one there. No kids or anybody were hurt. That's
well,
a local legend.
That.
So that does not seem to have any connection with, you know, with whatever was behind that field of terror, zone of high strangeness. Though it's possible that people had felt that sensation at the school before, and that, you know, over the years of people experiencing this, you know, terrifying, you know, sensation, that maybe a legend or folklore was created to try to explain it. And people knew that the orphanage had burned down, so
right,
they may
right.
have connected the two in their own minds, and that's what made the legend of the haunting.
Well, that could have been Native American history. That could have been.
Yeah, who knows what was on the ground
yeah,
at that spot, you know, and the entire
over.
Area. Yeah, that entire corner of Western North Carolina has a lot of Native American history, Native American occupation. So, again, who knows? It's just, it's an anomaly. It's one of those things, but it's definitely real. And when
no doubt.
You know, when you read about, you know, the sense of, you know, fear and terror envelop somebody, you know, at a haunted location, I know exactly what that feels like.
When you recognized that again in your home, well, when you experienced that in your home later, did you recognize that as a similar, almost exact experience?
Not exact. It was similar. And when at home, it happened twice. It happened two separate nights while I was laying in bed reading. But it came at home, it happened slowly and gradually. At the school, it was instantaneous. We crossed an invisible line, an invisible threshold, and boom, we were enveloped by that feeling. Then we drove out of it, and it happened twice. At home, I was laying in bed reading, and the house I lived in had been known to be a haunted house for decades and decades before I moved there. But I had never experienced anything there. But I'm laying in bed reading. First time it happened, the lights were on. I was not asleep. So there was nothing was dark. It was not hypnagogic or hypnopompic sleep energy because I was wide awake. But I just felt slowly something enter the room. And I felt it in a specific corner, specific spot in the room. The lights were on. It was night, but the lights were on. But I knew exactly what corner this was because I felt it. And slowly, over a period of a half hour, it just kept building up to the point where even though I couldn't see anything in that particular corner, I felt absolutely a sense of certainty that there was something there radiating a physical sensation, a physical energy field of some sort, of absolute terror, dread, and evil. And I just felt that I have to get out. But, and this sounds stupid now, talking about it and thinking about it, but I was actually kind of afraid to get up and try to leave because I didn't want whatever it was to become aware that I was aware of it. I didn't want to draw attention to myself, which really doesn't make sense now because I was there and it was happening.
I didn't know you were there, obviously. Yeah,
obviously.
It came to you.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know for a fact that knew I was there, just like that field that I crossed, you know, through behind my old school. Right, it could have been just something that, you know, just happened to show up, you know, whether I was going to be there or not. So I don't know, but I felt that there was hatred and I don't want to sound melodramatic because I'm not into this, you know, demonic aspect of this. But I do think that some cases, the phenomena that people perceive does behave or can seem that way and certainly be described that way. And in this case, I felt it was something evil and threatening. So I laid there trying to be quiet, trying not to look directly in the direction after I realized where it was. And eventually I just fell asleep, just laying there. Next morning I woke up, it was gone. I felt fine. I figured that was weird. And of course I knew the stories of the house being haunted, but it was not that kind of haunting stories. It was the ghost of a woman who had been seen walking throughout the house. My roommate.
Okay. So not threatening really at all.
Nothing threatening. Just a woman and the people in the house, my roommate and his mother who lived upstairs had seen the ghost of the woman, but nothing ever threatening. But of course I am aware of that. So I'm saying, hey, maybe this has some connection, but I can't understand what the connection would be. A few days later, maybe a week or two later, I'd have to check my notes, but the exact same thing happened. But this time I was asleep. The room was, the lights were out, the room was dark. And all of a sudden I just woke up. And instantly, as soon as I woke up, that sensation was there. Coming from that same corner in the room, I couldn't see because it was pitch black. But looking in that corner, my perception, what I thought I saw, was that even though the room was so dark, I couldn't see my hand in front of my face, I think I saw a figure or a black mass in the corner. And even though the room was so dark, you couldn't see anything, my perception was whatever this black mass was, that was radiating this terror, that the black mass was blacker and darker than even the rest of the room.
It's almost like a curtain.
Yeah, and it was a subjective feeling. I have no way to objectively, you know, document that was the case. And it might have just been in my mind playing tricks on me since I felt something in that corner. But again, I woke up from a sleep, just instantly bolted awake. And I wonder, why did I wake up? Did I sense this presence while I was asleep? If I woke up and it was instant, again, I'm laying there, I'm saying, you know, God, you know, make this go away, whatever it is, you know, get me through this. Again, I didn't want to get up and walk out of the room, because I would have had to have gotten up and walked directly in front and passed.
Well, it could have developed into a confrontation.
Yep. Well, I don't know if that would have happened. I just, you know, I only know the specific things I experienced, and I don't want to project, you know, what, you know, could have, you know, become. But I was just very nervous, very frightened. And, you know, and for me to say that, even today, it surprises me, because I am a fearless ghost hunter. You know, I go out and look for these things. I believe
they
exist. But
when they come look for you, it's a little different.
Yep. And I'm a fearless cop. But what am I going to do? I'm going to shoot the corner of my room because I sense something there. So no, but again, eventually I
you need ectoplasm.
Yeah, exactly. But I laid there. I believe I was, you know, saying a silent prayer, you know, because this felt overwhelmingly evil. And eventually I dozed off and fell asleep again. Woke up the next day. It was gone.
Do you have anything that you use for protection?
I've never felt the need for protection. I'm not into the religious aspect of this. I don't put any credence in burning sage, you know, carrying crystals, or imagining a protective white light against me. I know a lot of people do, and it may actually work for some people, because I think in those cases, if those methods do work, if they do, you know, tend to ward some negative stuff off, I doubt it's the ritual. I doubt it's the, you know, the chemical structure of the burning sage or the crystalline lattice of the quartz you're carrying. I think it's the intent. If you are, you know, saying, you know, this is going to protect me, this is going to keep something bad from happening, I think in many cases that intent can actually moderate the phenomena that's being experienced. In parapsychology, we believe a lot of stuff involving psychokinesis is because of intent. A person
Absolutely.
Wants something to move. They want something to disappear. You know, they want, you know, whatever. It's the intent rather than any specific, you know, ritual, even prayer. Prayer has an effect in healing people at a distance, where the person doesn't even know they're being prayed for when they're sick. And there have been controlled experiments done within parapsychology, where there are people who are sick. There's a group and a control group, where one of the people who has, you know, an illness has a prayer group praying for their health. The other person does not have that, but they don't know what group they're in. So the people being prayed for don't know if they're the ones being prayed for, and vice versa. And there has been some statistically significant results obtained from that, where the people who are prayed for actually have better recovery outcomes than the people who are not being prayed for. And that's been extended to things other than prayer, where there are no,
yes.
There's no religious prayer being used, but a group of people will, you know, just generate conscious intent. You know, I want, you know, John to be healed. I want, you know, John's cancer to fade away or whatever, while the other people in the control group are not having that done. And the people who are having the good, you know, well wishes generated in their direction do seem to have better outcomes. So intent,
well,
you know, human intent.
Positivity.
Absolutely.
Driven by intent is a powerful thing.
Yeah. And that might work, you know, as a protection mechanism when you're in certain unsavory, you know, paranormal interactions. So I don't discount it, but because I think it is psychological, where you're creating intent and actually affecting the outer environment with that, I don't think it really matters what method you use. And again, other than these couple of outlier cases with me, and mainly the one in my house, which happened those two times and never before or since, I don't really feel threatened. I don't feel a need to have a system to protect myself from anything. And if I started experiencing, you know, very negative and hostile fear-inducing things in the future on other cases, if it started happening a lot, my response would probably not be to develop a protective ritual or, you know, something. It would be to stop investigating those cases.
Yes. Well, we're at our final break, and we have a question for you to get to when we get back. It's probably going to be our final one, because I think it'll take a hot minute if you say yes. But we'll be right back. Y'all come back too.
You're listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experience Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Oh, come on. I'm Southern, but... nope. That'll do. Hello, I am Kat Hobson, host of Paranormal Experience here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting out of Birmingham, Alabama. I enjoy having guests from all areas of the paranormal, from ghosts to ufology to cryptids and beyond. You'll find some of the best researchers in their fields bringing you some great information. Join me on Wednesday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern here on WBHM Digital Broadcasting.
Since 1948, Fate Magazine has brought you reports of the strange and unknown, all of them true. Fate Radio is carrying on that tradition, bringing you the unusual, macabre, strange, and bizarre. Join host Kat Hobson Sunday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern on WBHM Digital Broadcasting. Listening to WBHM, Digital Broadcasting, the best in paranormal talk, only on Paranormal Experienced Radio, broadcasting live out of Birmingham, Alabama.
Welcome back for the final segment here on Paranormal Experienced, and if you have a question, better get it in the chat. We have one, Randy, that you and I had discussed a little bit about this before the show, and then lo and behold, here's this question. Have you ever had encounters with anything that you think may have had something to do with aliens?
I have not. I think there's much more evidence for the existence of ghosts, hauntings, and poltergeists than there is for the existence of aliens. Aliens on this planet. Certainly, I think there are aliens out there in the cosmos. And I do believe people do see UFOs. They do see unexplainable objects and lights in the sky. So, but whether or not those are piloted by aliens who come here and interface with people, there's not really any objective evidence of that. But it's certainly possible. I can't discount it, but I've never encountered anything along those lines myself. Though I can't rule out that some of these paranormal experiences I have had, that field of terror. I mean, heck, how do I know, that it was not an alien, that manifested in my room, or some interdimensional entity of some sort? My framework for viewing these things is to say it was a ghost or a haunting or some sort of anomalous energy field. But heck, that could explain, an alien encounter too. It might be the same thing in some cases. There is a correlation between people who have close encounters with UFOs, the close encounters of the third kind, where it's close contact with an entity, or a close encounter of the second kind, where it's close contact with a object or apparent craft. And people who believe and report they've been abducted by what they define as aliens. And people do have these experiences, whatever is behind them. But very often, people, when they have that UFO or alien experience or encounter, they will then, after it's over with, they will start to experience other paranormal activity around them and at home. People who have these close encounters or abduction experiences will report that they'll have poltergeist activity occurring in their home for a while after their UFO type encounter. And it's classic poltergeist activity that we see in what we term, you know, poltergeist cases: cabinet drawers opening and closing, furniture, you know, rearranging itself instantly when you divert your gaze, you know, for a half of a second. Classic poltergeist activity, and people who experience this after these UFO encounters. Why? What's going on? What's the connection? I'm clueless. But many UFO researchers and people who've written books on this subject,
right.
John Mack, I think Dave Jacobs, Whitley Strieber, they've all made the observation that exposure to the UFO type phenomena seems to trigger or is interrelated somehow with other forms of paranormal activity. So the connection is there. I've just never had, you know, a UFO or alien encounter myself, or nothing that I would define in that, in those terms.
That's just so interesting. And I really believe that all of the paranormals are interconnected. It's just, there's an awful lot that goes on. And Sherry was wanting to know, other than the experience in England, which had basically started as a clearing and actually became an exorcism, have you had any other exorcism experiences?
I have not. I don't work generally in cases that would need an exorcism. An exorcism,
right.
At least in terms of the Roman Catholic Church, applies to expelling a demon from a person.
Yes.
That term is not used, you know, for clearing a house, at least not within the Catholic Church. It might be in the, you know, Catholic and Orthodox churches, I think they call it a cleansing ritual. And I think some clerics do call it a minor rite of exorcism, which I think is what Reverend Willis did in,
yes,
England for me. But usually the cases I work don't involve stuff which requires demonic intervention. And normally I don't work with the clergy. I work with Reverend Willis in England because the TV crew doing the documentary wanted to, you know, have a religious point of view involved with the investigation. And I was very impressed by him because, in addition to talking about exorcisms and expelling the forces of darkness, Tom Willis and I had, you know, some very interesting late night conversations about poltergeists and ghosts and recurrent spontaneous psychokinesis. He was a true Renaissance man when it came to the paranormal. But other than that one case, I've not worked with any clergy or been involved with anything involving an exorcism. And if I ever came across a case where I thought there were signs of possession or obsession or infestation along demonic lines, even though I'm very skeptical of that, I'm also not an idiot, and I'm going to extricate myself from that situation and not work the case. I might refer them to, you know, their church of choice, but I personally am not going to investigate something that I think might be evil or demonic. I have enough issues with experiencing dark shadows at night in my old bedroom and how that affected me. I'm not going to go actively into a case looking to encounter that.
Absolutely not. Well, because, you know, I had a case that was handled, and, you know, we had cleared the home and done all these things, and it kicked back up again. And a group came in behind us and told the people that their 6-year-old was possessed and was causing all of the things and just ridiculous things. And they wanted to do an exorcism on the 6-year-old and did.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so freaked out that that had happened, that I just couldn't believe it. It's kind of that, like that, just the worst thing that they could have done.
That is, in my mind, totally unethical.
Yes, it is.
What, you know, ideas and terror have they put into the family? And what kind of long-lasting trauma have they put that child in? You know, telling the child, well, all this is because of you, because you're evil. Because the devil's inside of you. That is horrendous. And that happens quite a bit.
And it does happen. Sometimes, I was stunned.
Yeah. I was going to say what happens and what sometimes I'm ashamed to say is the field that we're in, because there are so many charlatans. And, you know, even if they had reason to suspect that maybe something along those lines was going on, you refer them to, you know, clerical counselors.
Yes.
You don't just come out and say your 6-year-old child is possessed by a demon.
That's
horrendous.
I mean, that is the only time that I have ever felt like marching up to somebody and just having an extremely strong discussion.
I would have if I was on a case and that happened, if the other people who said that were involved in the investigation, if I controlled the investigation, they would be out. They would be off.
They would be out, but they did not.
Yep. If I was
they
not
were
in
not
control
on my team.
Okay. Yeah. If it was then in that case, I would extricate myself from the situation.
I did.
Because I wouldn't want to be a part of that.
I no longer investigate with the team that was going, you know, that had been there, and because they were affiliating with that group. And I was just like, oh no, not just no. And you know, it still took me a while to walk away because I felt like maybe I could fix something. And I couldn't. You know, it was not my team. And it's a good thing that I made that change, because I do a lot better work the way I do it now. So, but
luckily,
go ahead.
Yeah, luckily I've never encountered a situation like that. But then again, I generally don't work as part of a team or with a group. If I'm on an investigation, I take a case, I'll bring in different individual specialists and subject matter experts who I think whose presence would be beneficial to this particular investigation, and people I've worked with before and trust. But I don't go out as part of, you know, Billy Bob's, you know, Demons and Ghosts Are Us club, or, you know, so and so county.
Well, that's basically what it was. It was just like, and, you know, they had gotten these little mail certificates that declared them demonologists and stuff. And I'm like, you are not
bless,
a demonologist.
Bless their hearts.
Yeah. I mean, it takes more than a piece of paper. And I was just so disgruntled.
Yeah. Ed Warren, notwithstanding, to be a demonologist, first you have to be a member of the clergy.
Yes.
Then, sponsored by that church, you're sent to special theological training to give you that title. And then what you do is basically sanctioned by the Vatican or whatever religious body you're representing. But you don't go out and take a mail order or internet course and get a certificate that says you're a demonologist. But so many people do that.
Yes, they do. And God knows what havoc they wreak. I know those people wreaked a fair amount.
Yeah, people like that and what they do, to me, is more terrifying than any ghost haunting or poltergeist situation could ever be.
I agree. And have you ever come across a portal? I know we only have 2 minutes, but have you ever come across a portal or something that you believed could have been?
The existence, the concept of portals, which is popular in pop culture, ghost hunting TV shows, and non-scientific research publications. It is a concept. It's a relatively new concept. It's not recognized as a thing by parapsychology. Parapsychologists have never detected something that they could consider a portal. So I can't say I've ever encountered that. I mean, it is conceptually possible, maybe even likely. There are certain spots on the planet where paranormal activity happens over and over and over again in a certain spot, even across centuries, like that yes. House in England where I work the case. So yeah, maybe there are some areas where the border between this world and another world are a little bit thinner. And they're predisposed to this kind of activity, but the existence of a specific portal, there's nothing in the research or the literature to suggest to me or my colleagues that any such thing like that specifically exists. Can't be ruled out, but there's no evidence for it.
Right. I was just curious about that because I've investigated with people that said that they felt them or saw them and stuff. And I'm very sensitive to energy and I've never felt one specifically where they were saying there was. So
I've worked with psychics who said there's a portal right here. This is where they're entering and leaving the house. Mm-hmm. And of course, as soon as they say that and point to the spot, I'm focusing, you know, all kinds of equipment and recording devices and energy detection devices. And I've never picked up anything. But, you know, maybe a portal does not give off that kind of energy signature. You know, maybe that's it's true. Something that we can't detect. And I can't say the psychic was wrong or didn't see what they said they were seeing. But that's not repeatable, documentable evidence that I can work with myself. So,
right. Well, I am sorry to see this show end. I have enjoyed you and your information, and I just am so glad that you joined me. Thank you.
Well, thank you. This has been a joy and a very fun talk, and I appreciate having the opportunity to answer some of the questions from the listeners.
Oh, please. You could go for days with these questions from the listeners. We have a great chat room. But I appreciate you. We'll have to see if we can do this again sometime. And you're getting all kinds of kudos, just so you know. But for our listeners, whether you're live or you're going to be catching our archives on iHeart, iTunes, Spotify, anywhere that you have a subscription service, you'll find us. But I appreciate y'all too, because y'all are the reason that we do these shows, and we've got some great hosts that you need to check out. Just go to WBHM-DB.com and you will see all the shows. Oh, and I'm to tell you how much they love you. So, the show and your information. And maybe you too, just as a man. I don't know. But I have great respect for what you do. I respect your training. And I had a good time talking with you. So
not as good of a time as I've had. This has been great. I enjoy chatting about this subject. I enjoyed talking with you.
Thank you. So we will, I'm going to go ahead and just let people know that I know there's a lot of angst, a lot of anger, a lot of people with attitudes and fear, and that comes out as anger, but you can change that. We all have the ability to manifest our environment. If you don't like what you see around you, be the difference. Change your world. And, you know, there's a great man named Corey Smith that wrote a song. You can only really find it on YouTube because he wrote it for a charity in Africa. But it's called Be the Change. And that's what we have to do. So go make your world a better place. Be a spouse you would love to have. Be a friend that you desperately need. And just rock your own little world and it will radiate out like you have no idea. So get to it. Have a great week. We will see you same cat time, same cat channel. Thanks. Good night.